Well, I've told you, it's a year of open doors. God's calling our church to do some new things. Our church has sown seed all over the world, and God is a God that when we sow seed, He brings harvest. So we're believing Him for harvest. And I'm believing over this year, God's going to open so many doors that we wouldn't even know to ask Him for, that we just need to continue to pray. And we've talked about the subject of imagine. And we need to press into what God has for us. Here's the scripture that we've been using in 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9. That is what the scriptures mean when they say, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love Him. But it was to us that God revealed these things by His Spirit, for His Spirit searches out everything and shows us God's deep secrets. And so that's what we've been praying. We've been praying, Holy Spirit, lead us to what You want us to have our spiritual imagination be focused on. Our imagination shows us things that are not yet reality. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Now, we can use that for negative, and we could let our mind just kind of go to all kind of things, fleshly things, worldly things, lustful things, or we could allow the Holy Spirit to use our spiritual imagination to begin to say, I've got things prepared over your life that you have not even seen or heard, or it hasn't even entered into your mind, but I'm placing them there by My Spirit. Is that good?
Yeah.
Anybody believe God will do the miraculous? You know why I believe that? Because I've seen Him do it. Amen. And so I'm asking you, and I've mentioned this, going to mention it real quick again this morning, to partner with us in 2017. And I need partners really in three key areas. There are many, but three key areas. Number one, prayer partners. I appreciate your prayers. This week, the enemy, you know, he wouldn't be a good devil if he didn't fight. And he's been fighting. And I appreciate it so much when people say, I'm praying for you, Pastor, because I need your prayers. Is that good? I want us to pray together and covenant together daily for prayer. And then secondly, consistent tithers. The Bible says that when we bring all the tithe into the storehouse, that God will open up the floodgates of heaven and pour out a blessing so there's not room enough to receive it. And that is true. I'll tell you, it's true. I praise the Lord that I was taught by my mom to be a tither when I was young, and I've tithed my whole life. And I'll just tell you this. Some people think that if I tithe, then I lose that money, and I can't afford to tithe. I don't have enough money. Let me tell you, you need to operate in blessing and stop operating in poverty and have that poverty spirit get broken over your life. And how you have the poverty spirit be broken is you walk in obedience to His word. You take a step of faith. And you say, I'm going to be a consistent tither. Some people have been inconsistent tithers. Tithe a little bit, miss a little bit. Start tithing again, miss a little bit. Let me just ask you, would you make a declaration? It's a good time. It's still the first part of the year that you and your spouse, that you just get together and you make a decision. We're going to become a consistent tithing family. We're not going to be in and then out and then up and down and all this. If God's blessed you, you need to say the first of everything that comes into my hand belongs to Him. Somebody say amen. And then thirdly, committed givers. Committed givers. Once we've tithed, then we can give. And as the Lord blesses us, and I've talked to you about the Imagine Fund. Last year, we gave to debt reduction, and this year, we're working on the Imagine Fund. I'm going to share with you about that tonight and all the things that we've shared with you that we're planning on doing. God's got great things in store. Is that good? Can you just imagine? Can you just imagine what God will do? Can you just imagine? You know, I think back to the beginning of last year, and I think it wasn't on my radar that God was going to do a miracle, let our church become debt-free. I think back to 2 years ago in January, it wasn't on my radar that year I had an incurable disease that I'd be diagnosed with and spend 20 days in the hospital up in Cleveland Clinic and not hardly be able to walk or speak and have a neurological disease that they said there is no cure for this. But God knew, and God brought healing and did what the doctors couldn't do. I don't know what 2017, all that God has in store, but I know God's got plans. Is that good?
Yeah.
And the problem is we limit him. We limit him by our lack of faith. You know, when Jesus went to his hometown, the Bible said he could not. And that, you know, that phrase just doesn't even seem to work. Jesus could not. Jesus can do anything.
Yes.
But the Bible said Jesus could not do many mighty miracles there because of their unbelief. Do you know the one thing that limits him in your life is a lack of faith? We've got to begin to just throw off the restraints that we've placed on the Lord and begin to believe him that he is the God that he said in his word. We need to stop thinking so small. Is that a good word? Your Bible says this in Isaiah chapter 54, verse 2. Enlarge the place of your tent. Stretch your tent curtains wide. Do not hold back. Lengthen your cords. Strengthen your stakes, for you will spread out to the right and to the left. I want you to hear that word over you, over your ministry, over your home, over your marriage, over this church, over Conneaut, Ohio. We need to get ready for an anointing that is greater than what we have been walking in. See, I'm believing for a growing, enlarging, strengthening, lengthening, just stretching out and spreading out and expanding anointing of the Holy Ghost that is greater than what we've walked in before. I don't just want to see God renew the work that he's done before. I want greater things. Is anybody believing with me? God's not calling us to mediocrity, church. He's not calling us to come in and sing a few songs and clap our hands and think, oh, we did our little duty and then just go on about our lives. God wants to show up in your workplace. God wants to show up in your home. God wants to do a work in your kids. Some of you have got prodigal kids that have went off and they've walked in the wrong path, and God's going to meet them right out there and he's going to draw them right back in. He's not just going to save them. He's going to turn them around and call them into ministry. He's going to place an anointing on their life. I'm telling you, we've just got to take off what we have in our thinking that keeps God in this little box and stop thinking so small. Somebody said, you don't have to get all excited. You don't have to. But you get to.
Yeah.
When Brooke was little, we took her to the Albion Fair. All kids should go to the fair. And I think Brooke was maybe about 4 years old. And at maybe 3 or 4 years old, we're at the Albion Fair. And we're walking through all, you know, of the barns over there, seeing the animals. And then we came to the barn with the pigs. That's a wonderful barn. Very distinctive aroma of the anointing of the pigs there when you walk in. And one mama pig had a whole bunch of baby pigs, and there was one pen with a whole bunch of baby pigs. And Brooke saw the little piglets, and she got so excited. I think maybe she's thinking of Winnie the Pooh. I'm not sure why, but she just thought, piglets. And she went running over to the little piglets. And you know, they're all over on one side, but then one of them gets spooked or scared. And when that one got scared, it took off running, and they all took off running and squeaking and squealing and ran over there off to the other side. And Brooke said something that we've joked about and laughed about for years. Here's our little 3-year-old daughter, and she said, "Slow down, little pigs." "Slow down, little pigs." Can I tell you, I was thinking about this yesterday. Greg, I don't hear the Holy Spirit saying those words to us. I don't hear the Holy Spirit saying, "Just slow down. Just slow down." I hope he doesn't call us little pigs, but sometimes. I don't think he's saying, "Slow down, little sheep. Just go a little slower." I think he's saying, "Let's go. Come on, stop holding back. Stop thinking so small. Let's begin to go into the enemy's camp and to take back what's been stolen from us. Let's begin to declare the word of the Lord. Let's stop being so timid and let's start standing on the book and start going forward and seeing God do what he said. Let's take up our sword and let's go into the enemy's territory. Let's begin to claim them back." Is anybody with me today? I don't think we ought to slow down for a minute. What we need to do, church, is we need to awaken our spiritual senses. Because sometimes we get in a slump. And if you're not careful, you will allow your spiritual senses to become dull. Has that ever happened to you? You know how you know that's happening? You go through the same routine on the outside. You're still in church. It's not that you don't love Jesus. It's not that you're not saved. You're still right there. But I tell you what, when your spiritual senses are dull, a move of God takes you by surprise. You're not the one that's anticipating and praying and sensing in the spirit, "Oh, God's moving and God's doing something." As a matter of fact, God moves and you just kind of stand back and go, "Whoa, where'd that come from?" And you, I know because I've been there. You know when you're there because the Holy Spirit moves, and spiritually, you had no idea. You didn't even sense it coming. Are you hearing me today? We need to tune our spiritual senses that we can ask the Holy Spirit, "Lord, I want to be right in the middle of what you're doing. I don't want to be taken by surprise by what you're doing." Are you hearing me? What if I would ask you this question? How would you answer this question? What's God been speaking to you lately? Think of what your response would be right now. What's God been speaking to you lately? Can I tell you, when you're going through hard times and trials and you get so focused on the stuff of this world and you get your attention off God, you might think, "Well, I don't really know. He hasn't been speaking a lot to me." And if he hasn't been speaking a lot to you, then my next question would be, have you been speaking with him? Have you been reading his word and asking him every day, "Lord, illuminate your word to me. Show me your will through your word." Do you get in the book every day? You know, here's the sad thing. Statistically, in the church, in this church, 87% of people in the church do not read their Bible every day. 13% of people that go to church, call themselves Christians, 13% read the Word of God every day. Wow. Church, if you're not in the book, you're going to be surprised by things God's doing. Because when you read his word, he speaks to you. If you're not in praying and seeking his will, and you're not in his presence daily, you're going to miss what God has for you. This isn't what's on my sermon to preach, but let me just say this. If you're playing around with sinful things that you know you shouldn't be playing around with, If you're playing around with stuff and you know, well, it's not right, but I'm just playing around and I can handle it and it's okay, you need to be very careful because you are in a dangerous place. And you need to make sure that you heighten your spiritual senses, that stuff, you need to cut it out of your life. It's not adding anything good, but the devil has a plan for you and you need to be very careful. That's a good word today from your pastor. Can I tell you, there's a stirring of the Holy Spirit right now. And the enemy's fighting with everything he can. And that's good. Because he's afraid of what God's going to do. There's a stirring of the Holy Ghost over this church. There's a stirring. You know, the man of the pool of Bethesda, the man of the pool of Bethesda was there. Jesus came. And the Bible said that at a certain time, an angel would come down and the angel would stir the water. Whenever the angel would stir the water, the first person in got healed. And he said, I don't have any man to help me. I need somebody else to help me. I can't do it. And he didn't realize that the one who created the angels was standing right in front of him. He didn't realize this was his day of visitation. He didn't realize that God was standing right there, that he had the opportunity to reach out. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords was present right there. Can I tell you, he's present right here. And sometimes we just keep on living in the same stuff. And he's saying, you don't have to live that way anymore. You don't have to make excuses anymore. You don't have to say, well, this is just how it's always going to be, because I've come on the scene. Right. We need to wake up spiritually. Yeah. We need to come alive in the spirit. That's right. Is that good? Yeah. We need to quit just going through the motions. And I know today's a little different kind of sermon. I'm kind of just preaching all over the place, but I'm giving you what I feel like the Holy Spirit gave me to give you this morning. Ephesians chapter 5 verse 14 says, awake, you who sleep. Arise from the dead and Christ will give you light. Awake. Sometimes we walk around and we're walking around, but we're dead. We're walking dead people. Everybody, you know, people come up and say, how you doing? Praise God, I'm doing great. How you doing? And you're lying through your teeth. Because you know that inside, your spirit man is struggling just to survive. Can I say, this is a safe place, to be honest. And when you need prayer, you need to walk up to somebody that you trust in here and go, I need you to cover me in prayer. I need somebody to agree with me right now. I'm going through a hard time. Is that good? And we need to get in God's presence and we need to awaken. You know, Jesus went down to Bethany. He went down to Bethany to see his friends, Lazarus and Martha and Mary. And when Jesus arrived, they met him and said, oh, Jesus, you're too late. You're too late. Your friend Lazarus, he's already dead. If you would have been here earlier, you could have done something, but this problem is too big for you to handle. Can I tell you, when your spiritual senses get dull, you'll get into problems and you'll think they're even too big for God. When your spiritual senses get dull, you'll get into problems and you'll think, well, this is just too much. It's overwhelming and I can't get through it. And I don't think God could even get through this. And that's what they said when Jesus came in. They said, death has already come. And Jesus walked over to the tomb. I know, I've been in that tomb. I've been to Bethany. I've been in the tomb where they laid Lazarus down in the cave. It's not easy to get out of. I have no idea how he got out of that thing. And Jesus spoke with authority. And he said, Lazarus, come forth. when he said that, all of a sudden, what everybody else saw as dead and done and gone and over started to have new life. There came breath. All of a sudden, Lazarus, and he came out and he's all wrapped up. They wrapped him up tight. They wrapped him in what the Bible calls, they wrapped Jesus in when he was a baby, swaddling clothes. It was tight wrapped clothes that he had to kind of jump like this. He couldn't walk out. He had to crawl and slither to get out of there. And they said, "Hey, look at him." And Jesus said, "All you people are around, get those death clothes off of him. He's not dead anymore. Some of you have been walking around in death clothes, and he's come to say, I've come to give you life. I've come to pronounce life, to pronounce life, to pronounce life. Stop operating in death. Take the death clothes off and begin to have your spirit man come alive." Could we operate in the Spirit? See, the Spirit isn't dead. The Holy Ghost, he's alive and well, church. He's alive and well. Every once in a while, I hop over on the keyboard and I got a setting over on the keyboard that's a real honky-tonk piano. And we'll start singing, "God's not dead. He's still alive. I can feel him in my hands. I can feel him in my feet. I feel him all over me. See, I talked to him this morning. He's still alive." We don't serve a dead God. Why would we have a dead church? Some people are worried about how excited we get. I'm worried sometimes about how quiet we are, church. We need to come alive. Well, I ought to start preaching. God has greater things to do in Conneaut, Ohio. We've seen God do some incredible things. We've seen God do the miraculous. We've seen God do the impossible. Can I tell you, by the power of the Holy Ghost this morning, hear your pastor, you ain't seen nothing yet. It's been prophesied over this church. God spoke to my mom back in the early 1980s. He showed her that he would do greater things in this church. When my mom got cancer and had brain surgery and they said, "You're not going to make it," she said, "You know, if the Lord has for me to go home, I'm ready to go. But I don't know if the Lord heals me, I'm staying here." She said, "I just don't know because I haven't yet seen the greater things that I know he's going to do in this church." When my mom got to the point, she had a brain tumor that regrew after they did brain surgery after several months, and it affected her speech so that she knew what she wanted to say, but every day she would lose more and more words, and she hardly had very many words left, and she'd look at me with a knowing look, with determination in her eyes, and she would just say, "It's greater things." And I would say, "Yeah, Mom, God spoke to you and he showed you the greater things he was going to do in our church, and you're going to see it." And can I tell you, she may not be here in the flesh, but she's seeing it. Can I tell you, God's going to do everything that he said he would do. He's prophesied and he's spoken greater things, and he's a God of his word. There are some people that speak negatively about this city and about this county and about this region. And can I tell you, I see the reality of what I see with my eyes, but there's a greater truth than what you see with your eyes. God's hand is on Conneaut, Ohio. Some of you say, "Well, I don't live in the zip code 44030. That's okay. You're a member of the Conneaut Church of God, so you're in on this. I don't care if you come from Erie County, Crawford County, Lake County, Geauga County. I don't care if you come from West Virginia. You can be here from Iceland. Yeah. I don't care where you come from. You're here. And I'm telling you, if you will awaken your spiritual senses, you're part of receiving the promise of God that he said, I'm going to do greater things. Can I tell you something the Lord showed to me that I never knew before? This was just about 2 months ago. I've always heard Conneaut means place of many fish. Conneaut Creek means river of many fishes. And if you're a steelhead fisherman, you love that, because when you here pretty soon, you're going to be driving out to church and there'll be trucks and cars all over Route 7 of guys standing down there in the middle of freezing cold water catching steelhead. And it is that. But in a book called Ohio Town Names by William Daniel Overton, on page 33, it says Conneaut is clearly Iroquoian and means, get this, this is where we live. This is the prophetic name over our city. Conneaut means there is an increase. When you're on the phone with somebody and they say, where do you live? And you say Conneaut, and they go, how do you spell that? And they try to use a Q and everything else in the world to spell Conneaut. Next time you can say, you know where I live? I live in a place where there's increase. I live in a place where we haven't seen anything yet. I live in a place of greater things. Can I tell you this morning, church, Conneaut, there is an increase. I said, there is an increase. It's prophetic back to our name. I had people ask me before, do you ever want to change the name of your church? You know, used to be that Church of God was kind of a thing, and you'd go in and you'd name the church by the town, and that's what they always did, but that's old school. Do you ever want to change the name? I don't ever want to change the name, especially now. I would never want to change the name, because every time you say Conneaut Church of God, you say, you know what we are? We're the there is an increase Church of God. I don't know what's happening in any other church, but this is the there is an increase Church of God. Every time you put your address on a form, when you send it off to the IRS and you fill out your tax form, just go ahead and you can put there in parentheses, there is an increase. Don't charge me tax on it. I don't know about you, but I'm believing God for an increase of souls. I said, I'm believing God for an increase of souls. I'm believing God for an increase of harvest. I'm believing God for an increase of prodigal kids coming back. I'm believing God for an increase of miracles. I'm believing God for an increase of healings. I'm believing God for an increase of the breaking of the bondages and chains and yokes on people's lives. I'm believing God for an increase of hope and an increase of joy. I'm believing God for an increase of the anointing of the Holy Ghost on this church.
Yeah. Yeah. Good word.
Have you caught that yet? You need to start believing God for increase, because it's coming in ways that you didn't even anticipate and you wouldn't have even known to ask him for. Because he said 2017 is a year of open doors. He said 2017 is a year of open doors. Are you believing God for opening doors in your life? Are you standing in faith and saying, God, I pray you're going to do those things I didn't even know existed? Can I ask you, it's not just good enough to shout about it, or when the preacher says it, just to say, oh, yeah, amen, I'll be in on that. If you believe it, then you have to stretch your faith out and walk it out in faith. Is that good? I want to tell you a word that one of our ladies shared with me. I was sick a few weeks ago. I wasn't able to be here. It was on Wednesday night. I was home and my throat was so bad I couldn't hardly talk, and my phone rang. And Jane Brooker called me. I'm so thankful for her. She called me. She said, "Pastor, I just wanted to tell you. I know you're not feeling good. You don't have to talk. Just listen. I just wanted to share something with you real quick." She said, "I was praying about you and about our church. And God says, the breaker has come. The breaker's come." And she began to give me a word from the Lord over our church. I want you to hear this today, because some of you are facing obstacles that seem insurmountable. Some of you are facing things that you think, this is too big, I can't get over this. But Jesus, the breaker, is coming. And he's going to break down walls that have held you back. He's going to break down walls with your family, with your kids. You look and say, I prayed, Pastor. I've been praying so long, and I haven't seen any movement yet. I prayed, and then it got worse. Don't you give in to the doubt of the devil for one second. Let me tell you, the breaker's coming. The breaker's coming. The breaker's coming. It's a season of visitation. Do you sense this in your spirit? It's a season of visitation of the Holy Ghost. Here's what the Bible says in Micah chapter 2, verse 13. The breaker is come up before them. They've broken up and have passed through the gate and gone out by it, and their king shall pass before them, and the Lord on the head of them. See, you didn't realize it. You thought, I don't know how I'm going to get through this. And God says, you don't think you're walking by yourself. No, no, no. I'm not just walking beside you. I'm going ahead of you. You don't even know what you're facing tomorrow, but I already went there. I've already prepared the way ahead of you. I'm breaking things open in front of you. Things that you thought you couldn't get through, I'm breaking down walls and barriers and obstacles that the devil put up, and he thought, oh, now I've got them. But the breaker has come. I said, the breaker has come. Yes. See, when Jesus come on the scene, I tell you, when he gets here, things break. Sometimes it's our mindset. Some of us get a stinking attitude. You know, the first thing you need to have broken isn't outside you, it's inside you. He's going to break what's been broken with you. If you're willing to say, God, I got a bad attitude, and repent of it. Can I preach for just about 60 seconds? Listen, if you got a bad attitude against somebody else in the body of Christ, you've been grumbling and complaining, and you're worked up and you're all upset, and there's all kind of junk and trash, you need to quit letting the devil use your mind as his personal playground. You need to go to God, and you need to repent and say, God, forgive me of this. I've sinned. You need to get it right with him, and you need to get it right with your brother or your sister. You need to go to them. You need to love on them. Ask them to forgive you. Because when that happens, you know what's going to happen? There's a spirit that's over your life. Some people have a complaining spirit. Some people have a gossiping spirit. Some people have a spirit of disagreement. And God wants to come and just break that thing off you. I'm serious. Some of you in your marriage, there's some stuff that needs to be broken. And you say, yeah, but she did. Yeah, but he did. Quit complaining about what they did. You need to go to God, get it right on your side, and you need to go to them and say, I repent and I'm sorry, and let the Lord deal with them on their side. But for everything with you, you need to do what's right. That's a good word. I want you to get a picture in your mind of what the wall is, what the obstacle is, what the thing is that you're facing. For some of you, it might be an addiction. For some of you, it might be sickness. There are some people that are watching right now, watching live on Facebook. I don't know if you know this, but you look around the room, you see how many people are here. Do you know on video, we will have more people see this on video than are sitting in this room. If everybody that sees this sermon just this week were in this room, we wouldn't be able to have chairs enough to seat them. There are some of you, you're home and you're sick, and I'm believing God right there where you're at. I am believing God for His healing. The breaker has come. You need to get some of it. Some of us, it's attitudes and mindsets. Some of us have a poverty spirit. Some of us have prodigal children. And some of you have things that have held you captive and held you back. And you need to get an image of that. And then you need to just close your eyes. And you need to picture the Lord coming in. And that obstacle is in front of you. And He says, let me go ahead of you and make the way. And all of a sudden, Jesus comes. And that wall, that barrier that seemed insurmountable, He breaks it and He destroys it. Jane said one other thing. She said, but Pastor, I don't know what this is, but then the Lord showed me a picture of a bridge. She said, I know God's saying there's open doors, and I know that He's saying the breakers come, but I don't know what this bridge thing is about, but I see it. Maybe that means something to you. It doesn't mean anything that I know of yet. And so I couldn't talk much that night because I could hardly get a couple words out. We started praying over it. She called me back. She called me back this last week. And she said, Pastor, I was praying, and the Lord showed me about that bridge. She said, He's the breaker. He's opening doors we thought were walls. He's breaking the way through. But when He breaks the walls down, if it was a normal breaking, there would be rubble everywhere. And she said, God says, we're not even going to have to walk through the rubble. He's making a bridge so that we can cross over. She said, God's calling us to feed the hungry, to help the oppressed, to restore, to minister, to bring healing and to bring revival. And there's a part for everyone. That's what she said. I wrote it down as she was saying, and I'm writing it on my iPad. You know what I started thinking of? I started thinking about Jericho. Can I paint a picture for you and then we'll close? So the first town that they come up against as Israel's coming into the promised land, they come up against Jericho. The Bible said the walls of Jericho were tightly shut up. Some of you are facing stuff like that. It's tightly shut up. These were not small walls. They weren't like our walls. We've got tough walls here. They're made of concrete. But these weren't walls like our walls. These were thick walls. I mean, I'm not talking like a 4-inch thick wall or a 6-inch thick wall. I'm not talking like a foot thick wall. I'm not talking like a 5-foot thick wall. I'm not talking like 10-foot thick. I'm talking on the top of these walls, they had chariot races. Two chariots could ride side by side on the top of the walls. Homes were built into the walls. These were insurmountable walls. And I want you to get this. Had God just came down and let there be a shaking so the walls kind of crumbled like we think of, like they just kind of fell over and just turned into rubble, if that would have happened, there would have been no possible way for the children of Israel to get through. They would have actually been a harder obstacle for them to get through if that would have happened than trying to scale over the wall itself. Are you with me? But when they marched around those walls in obedience to the Lord, they marched around for 6 days in silence. And then on the seventh day, they marched around 6 times in silence. And then somebody had a ram's horn. You didn't know why you brought that today. I didn't know why you brought that either. Greg said, hey, I got a ram's horn here today. You want me to blow that? I'm like, I don't know. Thought about it till right now. He said, when you blow the ram's horn, then let everybody in Israel shout with a great shout. And on the seventh time around, they shouted unto God.
voice of triumph. When they started shouting unto him, the Bible said the walls of Jericho fell down flat.
Hallelujah.
Those walls didn't fall this way. Those walls didn't fall this way. Those walls fell this way. They literally fell into the earth. So that if you were standing outside looking at this huge wall, a wall big enough that houses are built into it, that two chariots could race on the outside, they just shouted unto God. They didn't have any weapons. They didn't have any means of destroying this. They just knew who they knew, and that's God. We'll just praise him. And all of a sudden, those walls just went. It was like somebody just put them on a lift. And God just went. The walls became flat so they could just march right on in. See, some of you, you've been facing obstacles and you think, well, if God helps me, then it's going to be hard and a struggle and I don't know if I'll ever get through. I'll probably the rest of my life have this over my head. No, let me tell you, God's saying the breakers come. The breakers come. The breakers come. The breaker has come. They're going to fall down flat before you. Somebody stand up right now and begin to praise his name. Somebody start shouting unto God with a voice of triumph. Hallelujah. Come on. Somebody shout unto God. Don't give him a little bit of praise, but begin to praise him with all that is in you. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. Hallelujah. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. God, you have given us the victory. Lord, we thank you indeed that you're the breaker, that you've gone before us and you have prepared the way.
Hallelujah. Is that there's power in the name of Jesus to break every chain? That's a good song. Here's what we're, it's still early. Here's what we're going to do. I want you to get in your mind the obstacle. I'm going to have them sing this song one time. I want us to declare it. There's power in the name of Jesus to break every chain. And I want you to begin to declare this. Sing it with authority. There's a lot of people in this room. But then somehow or other, after we sing that through one time, we're going to start marching. We're going to do a Jericho march right around here. We're going to declare there's power in the name of Jesus to break every chain. I don't care if it's a yoke of oppression that's been over you. Maybe it's bondage. Maybe there's addiction. Maybe there's stuff going on in your life. Maybe you need a healing. There is power in the name of Jesus to break.